What is good? We're back. And the season is just about a wrap. This is the last time we'll come into your earwaves without the playoffs being started. Because by the time we record something next week,
it's true.
Playoffs will be in full effect. So we'll probably be changing up the schedule just a little bit and how we're talking about things. We'll do one more week here to help you guys out. We're people helping people. We're going to hit you with a... you know, the best trade at every position for contenders and rebuilders. Really, we're just going to have a conversation about some football players. So that's what we're going to do today. Appreciate you guys for tuning in all season, all the new guys, all the people who have been with us for a while, all the new subscriptions. We got tons and tons of stuff for you in the off season. We'll be switching gears here, like I said, over the next few weeks, looking more into the future. But we will start moving some like game review type stuff over to the main channel. Having a good time with that. So keeping some football talk going on the channel. Still have some fantasy stuff with that, but mostly kind of reviews of the week as football kind of marches on because we just like to talk football. So
we'll man, that's the best part.
It really is. And that's what we're going to do today, but we're going to use fantasy players of guys that we, you know, could see trading for, kind of buy, sell, hold here last week of the season. And then we got some trade, real life trade scenarios and questions on the next show. So make sure you tune into that. So let's start at the running back position. We've talked about these guys the last few weeks, whether I don't know if it was multiple weeks in a row, but for sure last week. And I feel like we just got to do it again here, right? We got Bucky Irving and we got Chase Brown, probably the two hottest players right now that everybody's talking about. So I felt like we got to do it one more because the stock just keeps going up, yeah. Right?
Yeah. Hansel is so hot right now.
Here, Mike's hot.
Hansel. Your mic's hot.
Yeah. So Bucky, Chase, last week we were talking late round first, pretty much kind of for both of those guys at this point. That's about like where you're even considering tossing them to somebody else. But neither one of us really want to sell for that, especially if you're a contender right now, right? Those guys are potentially carrying you into the playoffs here, into the championship. They activated some sleepy rosters, I'm sure.
Sure.
And
they're super young.
So it's not like they're not Alvin Kamara or Derrick Henry where you're like, oh, I just found some, cheap stuff here. I'm going to turn it around and get something. So I could see that there are certainly trades going either direction. If you're a rebuilder and you don't believe in either one of them for whatever reason, you could look at both sides of the coin here. For this, I guess, if you were chasing a championship and were able to buy Bucky Irving, what would be a price tag that you'd be willing to pay for him right now?
So you said they're not, it's not like the old guys, that Kamaras and stuff, like you just found something cheap. The beauty of this is they were cheap.
Mm-hmm.
They were cheap. Bucky Irving was a third round rookie pick.
Mm-hmm.
Chase Brown was coming into his second year and everybody said he was terrible. So I picked him up a handful of times for super cheap in the offseason. So they were super cheap, but they're also super young and they've become awesome. Right now, if you go on Twitter, there's nobody hotter than Bucky Irving.
Yeah.
Right. The boys are coming at you with all kind of stats and all kind of special metrics. Somebody just invented the Bucky Irving metric. I saw that today.
Yeah, of course.
Literally, it's called the Bucky Irving metric, why he's better than everybody else, mm-hmm. whoever played football.
Mm-hmm. We needed that metric before Bucky Irving was a thing. Now you just move the fucking goalpost because you found some numbers that make Bucky Irving stand out, just like you did all the time with all the numbers and why nobody gives a shit.
I will say that it was a quote tweet from a tweet in the summertime. So it really was. Bucky hype train is ridiculous. Chase has been kind of a slow build. Mm-hmm. And Moss finally got hurt and then he kind of like took off. But this last couple of weeks of Bucky Irving has been ridiculous. The question was, what would I pay for Bucky Irving?
Mm-hmm.
Right this minute, a lot. Right? I mean, like you said, you said it last week. Can't really put that genie back in the bottle. Rashad White's a solid player and a really good pass catcher.
Mm-hmm.
Well, Bucky's as good or better in pass catching and obviously way better taking the ball from the quarterback behind the line of scrimmage and running forward with it.
Yeah.
At a much higher clip than Rashad White. If I'm contending, that means I'm at this point, when we say contending, we're likely headed to the playoffs. And in this scenario, you're thinking definitely headed to the playoffs, and I'm trying to win a championship.
Yeah.
So that means, you know, bad luck aside, you're looking at trading away the first round pick that would be the 1-9, 1-10. You're hoping it's the 1-12 because you're trying to win, but it's a late first that you're trying to give away. And I don't see how you don't give that away easily for Bucky Irving right this second. And I don't know if anybody's going to take it. I don't think that's enough.
Yeah. I mean, I think you probably at this point need to have a first and then a player attached to said first. You know, like, would you trade away Ramondre Stevenson and a first to get Bucky Irving?
For sure.
For sure.
I mean, I like Ramondre Stevenson just fine, but like, to me, and as a dynasty value, like, that's a perfect example of a great throw in. That's not moving the needle for me to lose Stevenson if I can get a young, potentially elite asset.
DeAndre Swift in a first.
That's a little spicier, but you know, I was a little down on DeAndre Swift coming into the year, so I could still take that. Jay, you got height and weight for Bucky Irving.
He's sixth in missed forced tackles per attempt. So, I mean, what else do you need to know?
That's true. Make him a pro bowler.
Of course I have height and weight. 5'10", too small.
5'10", what?
195.
Not two.
That's plenty enough. I mean, obviously, you'd love to see it 210, but I mean, the man moves like he moves.
Well, there was nobody in the league that was any good under 200 pounds
ever
until like 3 years Charles. Ago. Yeah, it was an outlier and yada, yada, yada.
Yeah.
The metric is, if you just watch football and watch Bucky Irving play, you knew he was good.
Yeah.
He just didn't test well. And so you take the value dip, you buy it, and you hang on to Bucky Irving, just like you did with a bunch of players.
So before we move on from Bucky Irving.
But let's get back.
No, but stay in that. So we talk about what happened post-combine with Bucky Irving. Mm-hmm. He went out there, he didn't test well, and all of a sudden a lot of people said, okay, trash. He's not good. And he did. He went to, what, a fifth round in the NFL draft. But when we got into rookie season, Casey keeps talking about Bucky Irving. And I liken it to exactly what happened the year before when he kept bringing up Tank Dell. And I was like, literally, I was like, why do you keep I've said the story last year two or three times in the offseason. Like, why do you keep talking to me about
because
Tank
Dell? Because I don't care.
You got to leave me alone about this Tank Dell fella. And that was one of the things that kind of slipped through the cracks. And I knew that the Texans traded for him, traded to be able to pick him, but I didn't realize what a lot's going on in the weekend of the draft. And I missed the fact that the Texans gave up the third round pick to move to, you know, traded into the third round to get Tank Dell. And I was like, whoa, okay, perfect. Boom. We were literally arguing about who to draft at that point. The Bucky Irving thing, Casey literally is like, I'm not backing off my Bucky Irving. He just got cheaper. And so Casey's got a whole bunch of Bucky Irving sitting around his teams, and he's on one of the teams that we have together, and he's literally stepping right into Christian McCaffrey's spot in the lineup next week. Mm. He was in a flex spot this week, but he's going to have to go up there and sit beside Bijan Robinson next week because CMC just left, and he ain't coming back.
Yeah. So DeAndre Swift and a first or Bucky?
I'll take Bucky.
All right.
I'll take Bucky.
Pollard and a first?
Pollard has put a little more brightness on his star.
A little older than Swift, though.
Pollard's star got a little dusty in Dallas, you know, and it came out, and he's been
just
looking good in Tennessee.
Trying to find that tipping point here.
Yeah, so it's a good tipping point. I mean, right now is a terrible time to be trying to buy Bucky Irving.
Oh, sure. That's why I'm trying to find what.
Slash, if he finishes this hard.
Yeah.
Right? If he finishes hard like this and he stays healthy for a couple more games, and he just plays healthy and plays well until the Bucks get eliminated, then next year in the offseason, his ranking in the dynasty running back community is going to be very high.
Oh, yeah. I mean, he's already got to be pushing himself into the top 12 right now.
Which is crazy. I mean, we say this all the time. You found some money here.
Yeah.
But it's almost like this, you know, buy low, sell high, right? The selling on Bucky right now, it's high.
Yeah.
But it can go much higher. It can go much higher. Only injury is the gamble to buy him.
Mm.
The gamble to trade him away is the fact that it could go up. It's not going down outside of injury. He's obviously really, really good. And Baker has...
Well, and everything's pretty solidified outside of maybe the wide receiver position moving super far down the line for the Bucks.
I'm glad you brought it up like that because McMillan got all the snaps and like two targets against the Panthers. And so, and that's 2 weeks in a row that Bucky's been peppered with targets. So they don't have.
Yeah, I mean, three targets this week for him. But
well, yeah, he got peppered with handoffs in the second half when they
25.
When they yeah, exactly, yeah. 25. Chris Godwin ain't coming back to save the day.
Yeah.
So I just feel like Bucky's like that piece that they decided, you know, we're going forward with this guy's going to help save our season.
Hey guys, a quick reminder to head over to patreon.com/theffdynasty to sign up for a free membership to get access to the free Discord channel. Or hit your boys with the $5 holler and get access to extra shows, mock drafts, roster reviews, ADP, and player pages. All for your pleasure.
First, and a good player is kind of where we're at with Bucky, and may probably have to be a little younger for somebody to maybe move the needle, or maybe they're in a complete rebuild and they would like Swift in a first because it gives you more stuff.
Yeah, but Bucky Irving. But the reason you're still looking for that tipping point for me is because you've brought in like Rhamondre Stevenson, who doesn't do a lot for me in Dynasty. Mm-hmm. You know, even DeAndre Swift doesn't do a ton for me in Dynasty. Obviously, he's not super old yet, but he just...
Been pretty decent back and forth.
He was very decent in stretches this year. I get it. But the uprising in the Bucky herd right this second. If you're not on Twitter and you're, you got your little home dynasty league going and those guys aren't on Twitter, like Bucky has played well, but it's really come on late.
Yeah.
It might not be too late to go buy him in your league right now. And he might not be talking like I'm talking.
Mm-hmm. Josh Jacobs or Bucky Irving?
Dynasty moving forward. I mean, I'll take Bucky.
I'm still going Josh Jacobs.
There he goes. And Bucky's your boy. So that just tells you how much you love Josh Jacobs.
Well, I mean, Josh Jacobs is just tried and true, a fucking real deal workhorse who's been RB1 like pretty much his entire career.
Yeah, I know. It just comes back. It's always, you got your classic dynasty conversation here. I got a 22-year-old Bucky Irving or a 27-year-old Josh Jacobs.
Undersized, bad draft capital.
He's no good.
I'm still taking Jacobs there, so I still haven't really found a great tipping point here for Bucky Irving, so I guess we'll just move on here. Chase Brown or Bucky Irving?
Solid question. Jeez. Chase Brown or Bucky Irving?
Bucky's at 6'12 in the recent ADP. Chase Brown down at 7'10.
The people have spoken.
Garage sale 750 mark down from 10.
It's only two drafts, so it's...
The people have spoken. Man, honestly, that's splitting hairs. And one of the reasons why I think is because Chase Brown tied right here with Joe Burrow. Joe Burrow's on a super heater, and their defense is awful. Hmm. And they obviously got to pay people, and starting with Ja'Marr Chase, and I don't feel like there's any money coming around to save this defense anytime soon. So it's shootout central for the Bengals going forward. I mean, not that the Bucks have been – not laying it down themselves. I just feel like the upside for the Bengals offense, we've seen over the last couple of years, their defense has been like remember that whole thing where they were the best in the league, second half adjustments, and that old defensive coordinator they have would just shut you down in the second half? That is long gone.
Well, they've lost so many parts and pieces over the years from that defense that they got to figure something out.
Well, they don't spend any money. They don't sign any guys. And then when they had to go and pay Joe Burrow, they definitely ain't spending any more money.
Mm-hmm. So, Chase Brown, a first in DeAndre Swift? First DeAndre Swift, Chase Brown, same question? Well, so it's not that quick, so then you would rather have Bucky Irving over Chase Brown.
Yeah, Bucky might have just got the nod over Chase Brown because I couldn't answer that quite as quickly, but...
Healthy Swift is good. I mean, he's still not that old. Good. I mean, he's got to be 25.
Zach Moss is... got another year there, right? He should come back. I think Chase Brown has solidified himself as the guy there. I don't know why they would draft another running back. I mean, they certainly could, but like Chase Brown's good. He can catch passes, needs to get a little better in pass protection, but a very good runner, very explosive. This is the one thing Bucky doesn't have. If Bucky had explosive, fast, and was fast
line speed,
like he gets caught, But
40 yards down the field.
Right, right. No, that's literally the only thing stopping Bucky from being like the elite of the elite, right? He could put up just crazy home run hits. He has to hit a lot of doubles and then score, right?
Yeah, well, but Chase Brown, he's good. If Chase Brown could see like Bucky Irving, he might get a little bit more home run hits.
Yeah, I mean, he also doesn't get fed like Bucky Irving very frequently. But... I would probably go slight lean Bucky here. It feels like a little bit more traditional of a fit, but Rashad White's got another year on his deal too, at least, and he's not going anywhere. Still good, but obviously he's there and he's healthy, and Bucky's still being fed. It's no competition between who's the better running back between Rashad White and Bucky Irving between the tackles at this point. Like, it's just not.
It's not.
That's kind of the way I felt about it, and that's why I kept being so strong with Bucky, because I'm like, well, Rashad White hasn't been good as a quote-unquote just running back. Mm-hmm. Excellent pass catcher and should be featured more in that role to do more things every week, I should say. I would say slightly Bucky there. James Cook or Chase Brown or Bucky Irving?
Wow. Out of those three, the James Cook, the Pacheco, and the Rashad White this year, that conundrum that was like, mm-hmm. how do you value these guys? I always said I'd like James Cook to come out and do better this year, but he's done amazing. He really has. Sometimes you get a little caught up in that dynasty young running back stuff. James Cook's probably the right answer, but based on what I've seen in the last couple of weeks, it's going to be hard to put somebody in front of Bucky Irving.
Yeah, I would agree. I'd agree there that, you know, I think there can be more competition arising for James Cook. I think they have figured out a good mixture here with Cook and this offense for the Buffalo Bills, and obviously a good offense to be tied to. Cook's made me a lot more comfortable to draft him for sure.
Agreed.
Bucky and Chase both could be letdowns here coming into next season, but I don't really see why they would be, right? Mm-hmm. It feels like people are going to want to give him the Kyren thing of like, well, you know, play this guy more, do this with this guy more, and for whatever reason, because there wasn't a big crowd that loved either one of those guys.
Yeah,
that they. It
but
just
no one
seems
ever jumped on the Kyren train like right. They are the Bucky train, though. Like Bucky's getting love. Kyren's never gotten.
Well,
any love.
When Kyren comes out of nowhere and scoring a bunch of points, people like it because it's helping him that season. But when we get into the season where we actually have to draft these players, then at a startup value, people are hesitant. And then this year, finally, after you know you got some good Kyren love coming into this year, but people were still like, drafting Kyren in the fourth round, I can't do that. And it's like, okay. I mean, you're just going to let this keep happening for, you know, until Kyren's not a Ram anymore or gets hurt or whatever. And I think Bucky and Chase are eventually going to be the same way. All right. Let's go to Garundo real quick here and we'll get out of the running backs. Actually, that's true. I got one more. Mason got hurt. CMC got hurt. If you're a rebuilder and you happen to draft Garundo this year late or picked him up or whatever, you could probably make some money for a contender right now, right? So you could play this either way. And there's really not to say that there isn't any reason not to hang on to Garundo because he's looked fun. He's obviously fast. You know, you want the Niner running back if he can get on the field. People have wanted a lot of him and they never even see the field because they just stink. But, you know, Elijah Mitchell will be there. Jordan Mason, I believe, is a restricted free agent. I would wonder how that works out for them. You know,
they
bring him back
cheap.
For pretty cheap next year.
Why wouldn't they?
And we don't know what's going on with CMC. So this seems like would you take a second for Garundo right now if you're a rebuilder?
A rebuilder? Probably. It's probably
good, I think so too.
Probably a good catch out. I will say that I got a really, really solid championship type squad going and I'm very thin at running back. I got Bijan and Chase Brown, and that's it. And that was the team I went to look at. And I got Garundo on the taxi squad. Mm-hmm. And so now I'm like, all right, I got a third. I got a backup. I got a plan B if I get to the playoffs. Because it was like
catch a hamstring.
Yeah, I wasn't supposed to be this good that fast. It was I just started it up 2 years ago. And I got three first round picks next year. It was a slow build. Go out and get a bunch of young dudes and stuff. And I'm all right.
Yeah,
I'm all right pretty early, but I don't have a lot of running back depth, and Grindo's out there. Like, so I'd be hard to tell to take a two for him right now off of that team, just because if I just go and, you know, make the championship game and get second or, you know, first or second place, he can stay on my taxi squad if I don't need him. But I need that's insurance for me right this second. You know, if I had two or three other guys, if I had, you know, Kamara as depth or something, then I could sell Grindo, but I don't have any other depth right this second.
Would you rather have somebody like Garundo or like a Lloyd or a Wright, another running back who didn't play a lot but may have a better opportunity kind of moving forward potentially to?
Fantastic question. The problem is,
those other guys.
The problem is this is San Francisco. If this was any other hole opening up, that might be different. This is San Fran, and we just saw Christian McCaffrey. You know, I don't talk like this often. Is that his last carry? We see him in a Niners uniform. Like, is he going to go and rehab and come back next year and be like, I'm just going to be.
I would assume so.
I hope so.
They
just
gave
saying.
Him an extension.
They just, yeah, he's paid. He's exactly. He should be fine. But what if he comes back next year and then he blows something out early and Mr. Garundo's sitting there going, what if he plays good for a couple weeks too?
I mean, he's looked good in
Everyone
spurts.
Looks good running the ball behind
in San Francisco. Exactly.
Right, but he could get hurt and then the next guy will look just as good. You know what I mean?
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
You almost got to capitalize on these big value boosts, especially with CMC looming. But like
today,
Wright, Lloyd, I gotta cash in and get one of those guys. Just
I get it. You know, it just we're you still got
the incumbents there are not.
You still got Achane.
I mean, Jacobs obviously is
still got
Achane. So I'd rather have Wright, but
Achane's good.
Sure, but they want to mix in another guy.
They do.
It would seem so. Garrendo just has the juice to, if for some reason,
if he can see those holes open up,
if for some reason Christian McCaffrey,
he can hit him,
isn't well,
right?
He's not good.
All right. One more before we get out of the running backs, and then we'll move a little quickly through some of this other stuff. We got B-Rob, I think, is to me the perfect Brian Robinson, a perfect recipe for a league winner right now. Eckler out on IR. I can't imagine Robinson's going to cost you an arm and a leg. Mm-hmm. If you're a rebuilder, maybe you don't want to get rid of Brian Robinson because you like where the Commanders are going, rather. If you're somebody who's going to try to win a championship, this guy's just set. They want to run. They move the ball pretty well. They pick up first downs. They control it. They run a decent amount of plays, and they want to run. B-Rob got in there, had a nice game this week. C-Rod came in. They put
B-Rob, C-Rod comes in.
Chris Rodriguez comes in.
Have you
in.
Said Brian Robinson's
yeah,
name
Yeah, I said okay, it to okay. start it. And, you know, specify they kicked the shit was. Out of Tennessee.
Yeah.
But B-Rob's a guy who can catch really well, as well as you can lean on him and pound it with him. I just feel like if, you know.
40-yard touchdown run.
I'd gladly give you 2-2s for B-Rob right now try to go win a championship.
Easily. I'd give you 2-2s. As quick as I said I'd give you 2-2s, I don't know if I want to give you the first, but I'll give you a 2-2. I'll give you 2-2s for B-Rob. I'll give you a 2 and a 3 and a 4. I'll layer it up however I need to.
Yeah.
I'll give you Garrendo and a 2, I think.
Yeah.
You know?
I mean, obviously, you're gearing up for a run. Garrendo,
right.
might not need to do anything.
Yeah.
Might be better long-term moving mm-hmm. forward. Obviously, I don't know how much of a thorn in the side Eckler or somebody else is going to be there because they do seem like they want to mix it up a bit. But B-Rob had a hell of a run to start the season here.
Yeah.
Then was just a little banged up through the stretch. So B-Rob, one of my favorite trade pieces running back-wise.
I like that too because, you know, the Redskins here, Commanders, whatever, Washington, I think we could say Redskins, they're trying to get it back. They had a nice little down stretch there, mm-hmm. right? They started 7-2, lost 3 in a row, two to good teams, one to Dallas inexplicably. Then this week, everybody was on the Titans +5.5, +6, or whatever it was. Mm. Everybody was like, oh, the Titans defense, and then Will Levis has been playing better. I don't know what happened because I didn't get to watch that game. I just know
it was awful
that the Washington kicked the crap out of them. So if they catch that mojo again, because they lost it for a minute, but if they catch it again, I love that buying, quote unquote, a little bit low because the B-Rob hype train was here. He got nicked up for a couple weeks. Washington lost a couple games. Like, there's your windows of the buy sell windows in this league for fantasy aren't always very easy to see, and they don't last long sometimes. I got a lot more to say about that later.
Yeah.
Anthony Richardson. So anyway, they don't last long sometimes, but this one is there for Washington.
Brian Thomas.
Brian Robinson. Oh, yeah.
Brian Thomas had a window there, and then it just scored a bunch of points.
Couldn't even get back to the mics this week to talk about it.
That was a bummer. All right, let's switch to the receivers real quick, and we'll talk about some buy-sell holds. Who do you think is going to be this year's, like, Nico Collins, right? Somebody who has a good season, but everybody in the offseason finds reasons, and while valid or unvalid, to say, hey, we're not putting him at the upper echelon of the mountaintop here because they bring in Stephon Diggs and Tank Dell's there, but we know that the quarterback situation's pretty stable and good. Who do you think could be somebody that you should plant your flag on now?
Ceedee Tillman.
That you should, that's I like it.
That's a good one.
That could be, people are going to give some yeah buts, but is going to come out of this thing looking like a boss.
That's a great question. I'm going to need some choice. I'm going to need multiple choice on that one.
Well, I don't know that I have a bunch of multiple choice, but Cedric Tillman is a good one for me. I like Cedric Tillman. I don't know what they're going to do, but I don't know what their cap situation is going to be and how they're going to navigate it for the Browns. Even if you just bring Jameis back on a, you know, $10 million, $15 million deal or however you can finagle it to play one more year and try to work you out of this situation that you're in, if that's what you want to do. You could do that, and Cedric Tillman's going to be just fine.
That would,
right?
I don't know why that's not the obvious choice.
I mean, Sam Darnold could be another choice, but he's probably going to want like that $30 million contract mm-hmm. for 2 years or something, you know, like a Geno Smith kind of mm-hmm. Baker kind of deal here. Jameis, he needs that one more year we just paid Sam Darnold $10 million and he played really well.
Exactly.
Now you can get 30.
Yeah.
So I could see that, but I think it's Ladd McConkey. I think that would be my first. That was when I asked, when I wrote the question, that was the first thing that popped into my head.
Okay.
Because he's having a good year this year. It's not out of this world. Been nicked up through it. But everyone expects the Chargers to add another person. They've been linked to T. Higgins at the trade deadline.
I mean, they should be adding.
And if they absolutely
they
should
will.
Be.
Then they
most likely will add. Although Harbs is a guy who traditionally maybe doesn't have the most powerhouse receiving core. Mm-hmm. They should and probably will add somebody
he had
else.
Nico Collins, didn't he?
Yeah, but he wasn't absolutely slow.
He wasn't Nico Collins. Well, he didn't have a quarterback at Michigan either.
But that's what I'm saying. Like, they're probably going to add somebody. It really could be a huge name, like somebody like T. Higgins. Yeah. And then there's going to be, well, they don't throw it enough for Ladd, yada, yada. I don't need Ladd to be getting 12 targets. I need Ladd to be getting 6 targets that he's not the focal point of. Mm-hmm. And, like, he's really hard to guard. He hasn't been, every game he's holding his shoulder.
Yeah.
And, you know, he's
kind of tiny.
50% just, market share yesterday.
He's just trying to, you know, but he makes it through. And then he plays the next, you know, he's missed a game, maybe. He's been really solid pretty much every week. If you have to start him, you certainly can. And then he's had games where it's like, fuck yeah, that's a great game.
Oh, yeah.
Looks awesome weeks. Out there. He can get. There's no, I think you got to put all the questions of whether he can play in the league to bed.
Best part was right before, literally Sunday morning before things are kicking off, I'm just looking on Twitter for some kind of little, just something that gives me some conviction to make a pickle in the contest, right? I've got to pick a couple teams to get lines against the spread. One of the last things I read before kickoff was, oh, Ladd McConkey is this and this and this against man, but it drops off by 70% against this, this, and this against zone. And Falcons run all this zone, so Ladd McConkey ain't going to do nothing today. And he had like 8 catches before halftime. Yeah. And I was like, that is what this is all about. It doesn't even matter. I mean, you know, like some of that stuff helps, but like.
It certainly can help,
Ladd,
but like.
Ladd got 50% of the market share.
Yeah.
Of the target share. Yeah. You know, he's obviously growing with Justin. I said it before, like everybody, like you just said, oh, they don't pass it enough and they're going to be super run heavy and this and this. They were 5 wide first snap of the season.
Yeah.
You know, so anything you think about how that offense is supposed to.
Don't put them in a box.
Don't.
They're going to continue to evolve this thing.
They brought
when over, they want, when they need to run, they're going to run. And when they need to pass, they're going to pass.
Right. They brought over Gus Edwards and then first snap of the season, everybody's like, they're just going to run.
They've
it.
They've been out here with a ragtag bunch of running backs. Them boys brought in J.K. Dobbins.
Ragtag Gus bunch of receivers.
That's what I'm saying.
I'll take my brother's core.
Yeah.
Ragtag
yeah.
receivers.
Six core is leftovers.
Yeah. All right.
One Harbaugh's trash. Another Harbaugh's.
Buy, sell, hold Terry McLaurin as a competitor going into the championship run here. You buying Terry?
Oh, easy buy. I mean,
How much are you spending for him?
Last week I said I didn't want to get my first round pick. I still don't want to give up my first round. He didn't get any younger. If anything, in fact, I think the way it works, he's a week older. I think he's a week older.
Would you give
older.
Up the first round pick right now going into the playoffs? Mm-mm. No? Mm-mm. I would.
I don't want to do it.
I'll give it to you. He's like wide receiver 2 or 3 on the season. It just keeps getting seemingly better.
It's getting better.
I'll give you the late one to try to go win something.
Somehow me and Foreman have like the second most points scored in the FFD3. And
look at
McLaurin,
you.
Saquon.
Terry and that'll do it.
Saquon.
2,000-yard rusher.
Yeah.
Burrow's going to win everybody that has him a championship. All right, so Terry
Josh Jacobs a sprinkle on.
Terry's a buy, but you don't want to buy him. But I'll buy him for the late first. Good ad. I don't know if you'd get him, but some people are rebuilding right now and would love to get a late first for Terry going
into
being 30 years old next year. But finally has a quarterback. Seems got plenty of juice.
I think only took him to his 29-year season.
I mean, he's always been solid.
He had a quarterback. What's crazy is he's never had a quarterback.
Right. Always.
He finally does.
You're going to get 2 years of least of slaying from Terry. He ain't stopping next
year.
He's
wide receiver 2?
Yeah.
Suck it.
So, you know, I'd throw you a 3-2 if I'm ready to compete.
Whoa, a first and a 3?
Yeah, because he ain't dying. I just, you know, I'm going in. You know, I don't, you know, when they're in that week 6, week 8, we can have that and anything can happen. You could be out week 1 having a great team for sure. But you can limp into the playoffs and win the whole thing. Anything can happen. But, you know, I'm here to win money and I'm going to give myself the best odds. If I got a really good team and I don't need to do anything, whatever. But like, hey, if my last flex is a little unstable and I can go and I'm coming in here and the third most points scored, second place.
Yeah, yeah.
I'll.
I think you just flew right past one of the best things you said was, it ain't week 8.
Was it on the mics?
For the OGs, I don't even know. We've probably never even said this on air, but like, it's an inside joke.
What?
you used to say this shit all the time. You'd be like, man, that's the best thing you said all night, and it wasn't even on the mic.
I used to say that
all the time, man. It would drive people, it would drive us crazy. It's like, just diminish everything we did on the mic.
Oh, yeah.
But like afterwards,
oh, yeah.
You'd say some shit and be like, that's the best thing you said all night, and it wasn't even on the mic.
Well, it's because you need to step your game up. You know, it's constructive criticism.
I'll just be chilling in regular days, like not even. That's the best thing you said all day. It wasn't even on the mic.
So. Nice. Just trying to lift y'all
he
up.
He said, wasn't on the mic.
Took me a few years, but I got it. Yeah. Got it on here.
I'm glad.
Laid it down.
We've been waiting on that. I've been waiting on you to bring it together here.
Get your shit together.
You got 1 week before the playoffs start.
Mm-hmm.
So it's not week eight anymore. So you're not buying a veteran that still needs to make it healthy for six more weeks. Right. Like, that's the beauty of it here is, like, if you're going to buy Terry, you're going to go out and buy Joe Mixon, or go to buy this person to this person, or buy some old guys. Because if you buy a younger guy and he gets hurt, whatever, yeah, hopefully you still can win the championship, yada, 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 because anything can happen. But if you buy an old player for this year's run and he gets hurt, but now you got one more week before the playoffs.
You're in the run.
You 1 week. So you buy.
So that was what he. That was the best.
That's what
thing
he said.
That's
the best thing
week,
he said.
It's not week six or eight.
Years.
Blew right by
that's
it.
The best thing he said in 6 years on the show.
And it was on the mics.
He nailed it.
And we got it recorded.
All right, Jameson Williams, buy and sell and holding right now, because I could see it going either way. Even if you're a rebuilder and you have Jameson, you might want to say, "Hey, I'll re-roll this. I'm fine with it." Or you're saying, "Hey, just the beginning. We've only just begun."
I mean, there's definitely a big part of this. Just the beginning for it.
Got to buy that guy.
If you're looking at the ball flip this week where he threw it in the defender's face on the sidelines, where you're saying, I don't know if you saw it.
Yeah, he tripped him going out of bounds. That's why he threw it in his face.
Yeah, and he threw it in his face. You know,
I'd have done the same shit. Like, Campbell comes, fuck you, pussy.
Yeah. Campbell comes out after the game, and he's like, yeah, we're good. But, you know, Williams got up in front of the team, unsolicited. Nobody asked him to do it. He was like, yeah, my bad, guys. I don't want to be a distraction. You know, like, Campbell. And
did he?
And one of the biggest things is – Jameson got suspended for two games a couple weeks ago for PEDs or shooting up or something, you know, trying
he doesn't
to be,
even need it.
Trying to be bigger, faster, stronger. And they boys put him right back in there and threw him targets. It wasn't like that he didn't need a slap on the wrist. It wasn't like sit out for the first half.
They probably gave him the steroids. But,
yeah, you know, it's a horse steroid. Let's get, must you know, whatever. Like, it's just like they are completely okay with what's going on over there with Jameson Williams right now. And there's definitely a little piece of it just keeps, because that was what coming into this year, the Jameson Williams hype was, well, every time the coaches or Dan Campbell gets asked, you know, who's his favorite player, or who's he's seen the most out of, or who's he's the proudest of, it was always J-Mo. Well, it's come out and it's obviously reflected on the field, and he got suspended again and they're okay with it.
Yeah.
And he throws the ball in somebody's face on the sideline and gets, you know, then they're okay with it. And
I think,
like,
they knew what happened, and then for him to just come out and be like, hey, my bad. Like, he tripped me.
Yeah.
And he probably didn't say that. He just apologized, didn't want to be a distraction. But them boys all knew by that point that what's his face had tripped him going out of bounds like an asshole.
What a dickhead.
Yeah.
And you know, you're playing parents the game. Jameson's already a little running hot. Mm-hmm. Already runs hot a little bit. And you know, when you're in between the two white lines,
he's super fast. He would run hot.
Tank Dell, worried about him long term?
Nay.
Long term, probably not. Obviously,
probably not.
Was
the biggest Tank Dell lover in the whole world?
Yeah,
sounded like a little bit of hesitation.
You can't be 100 miles an hour on somebody and they come out in neutral. And not
double down, bro. I got your back. I was like, he's brought up Tank Dell on the phone call today. I was like, it's great rebuild buy.
Great rebuild buy.
You said probably.
Well, you said you're slowing down.
Probably are great.
But you said, are you still as high as you were? You can't be as high as you were.
I just said, are you worried about him long term?
Are you worried about him long term? He didn't say, are you as high as you were on him?
I'm not worried about him long term. Probably. Compared to what I've seen like now, but I'm worried about him long term to compare to what I wanted him to be 3 months ago. You got to be able to be, you got to pay attention to what's going on.
I think there's just, I think he had a weird offseason, some injuries. We saw that happen with a multitude of guys with same sort of injury that he had. Tony Pollard
didn't get hot.
Mark Andrews, you know, has taken a while. And then, I mean, Tank Dell got shot too, didn't he?
He did get shot. Yes, he did get shot.
Like,
forgot about that.
Yeah.
Breeze by that.
So, I mean, I think it's just he doesn't look quite as explosive.
I bought a lot of Tank Dell.
Right.
On the high.
Mm-hmm.
You know, buy low, sell high, right? I buy high all the time. I got no problem buying high. Because I want to buy before it gets higher.
La, 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 la.
Well, I bought high on some Tank.
How high?
And Tank's not as high as when I bought him.
Yeah.
You know?
I mean, sometimes.
So can I buy high, can I buy where he is again? Yes, I can definitely double down, triple down, and
the
get
second,
in.
Second, yeah. Third time you get high in the
But
day,
you can't feel
well.
The same way you felt about Tank Dell now that you did 3 months ago, because if you, that's. You're not doing
you
something
didn't,
right.
You didn't buy Kodak at its end. You bought Tesla when it was a little high, and now it's dipped down, but you're like, I'm going to be all right.
Buy some more.
Yeah.
Just keep buying Tesla.
Yeah.
No matter what.
All right.
I could buy Tank Dell for sure.
Let's run through the tight ends real quick, and if we have time, we'll get to the quarterbacks.
Bought some hymns the other day. Not per,
really
I didn't
narrow
buy
it down,
but like stock, I bought hymns
it's
at like
for
19.
Your hair, for your dick, for your dick hair,
everything.
Well, that's what I figured. I was,
they got everything.
They do the
they got hers.
They do they have hers?
They got hers. They help your pecker out apparently, and then they got the hair.
Hers.
Uh-huh. When I realized they had the hair and the below the pants situation, I was like, I gotta buy some of that stock. Haven't tried it, but I mean, they're everywhere. They're you know.
Yeah, hymns holler at
it's
us.
Been
Let's
up.
Go.
It's
We'll all be Stockholm, rock hard Stockholm, doing this podcast. Yeah.
To raise the table a little. I blue chews. You
it's
can
not you, it's me.
Too. I'll see what's up with the blue chews. All right. Tight ends, Jonnu Smith, Tucker Kraft.
Table will be leaning.
Straight tripod, y'all.
Tucker Kraft.
Jonnu Smith, Tucker Kraft. Doing Jonnu, especially doing really well right now. Tucker Kraft playing really well. So let's go Jonnu Smith first. Buying Jonnu for a run here?
Absolutely.
Okay.
For the run. He is obviously 30 years old-ish. Maybe he's 29. Been around the block for a little while, but as I told 6'3",
249. So according to some people, there's no way he could be good.
6'3", 250. I'll take it. So
248, whatever.
My narrative around Jonnu Smith is right now, this is what his potential has been all along. This is why the Patriots paid him a lot of money a few years ago and it just couldn't get it figured out. Right now, the Dolphins are like, hey, Jonnu Smith, you're 6'3", 250. You're basically a wide receiver trapped in a half tight end body. Like, we got a quarterback that we cannot have hold the ball more than a second and a half because we can't get him hit. If Tyreek Hill's not open right away, he's throwing it to Jonnu. If Jalen Waddle's first read and it's not like what we've seen from the Dolphins and Tua the last couple years was a little bit of pocket presence and some wild, like ridiculously accurate passes, deep middle, long, like, not long throws for most NFL quarterbacks, but a decent looking 40-yard, you know, shot down the sideline. But the timing and the accuracy was ridiculous, making it look like his arm wasn't quite as weak as it really is, because it was ridiculous. It was just crazy the timing, crazy the accuracy, crazy the space that McDaniels could draw up with the offense. Now they're like, well, we just paid this dude, and his noodle is literally loose. Like, we cannot let him get touched. And there is a check down Charlie situation going on with Jonnu Smith. And then when he gets it, his yak is ridiculous because he is,
pretty athletic.
He's pretty, pretty, very athletic.
Yeah. I think it's a combination of that. They're obviously throwing it to the back a lot, but I think they're just, you know, the defense is playing kind of a shell, trying to focus on the other two guys, take that stuff away. Now we got stuff underneath open. We can get it out to those guys.
Is Jonnu contractually there?
He's there next year.
Next year. Right.
So you could.
So I buy him for the run.
Buy him for 2 threes right now?
Yes.
Buy him for a second right now?
Late second for sure.
All right. Let's go Tucker Kraft then. Let's keep this thing moving.
All right.
Obviously, Musgrave has been out since September, I believe.
Mm-hmm.
Tucker Kraft's been pretty good through there. People have already got Tucker Kraft stamped as the Packers tight end. He's, you know, moving up dynasty rankings for people.
As he
should be somewhat. I am personally, like, I'm not buying Tucker Kraft for a run here. There's a lot going on.
Nope.
I'm good. I'd probably be trying to sell Kraft if I could. And maybe he comes out and he's just always their guy from here on out. Musgrave is a very good player. He was pretty green to start with, and now he's missed some time. We've seen him be very good on the field, but all of a sudden he gets back in the mix, and we're right back where we were at the beginning of this year, where there's five guys
even more crowded
where it's going. Now maybe Kraft has really just carved this path out, but I just, you know, it was a precarious drafting situation for them. It's obviously worked out because when they've got one on the field, but I think they want both of those guys on the field, and I don't know. I think Kraft's a good player, and I thought Kraft might jump out and take the role for a while and then Musgrave come and get it from him, because Kraft has played a minute, Musgrave hadn't, mm-hmm. like just as far as reps. So, I mean, we're seeing that, but for a different reason than I maybe thought there would. But I like Musgrave a whole lot. And I still think that all that potential is still there. So I would be probably buying Musgrave. Now, obviously, you're talking about trying to talk about for a title run here, but I'm looking at the other side of it. Like, I'd be trying to maybe sell Kraft. And maybe he'll come in there and just really help you out through that run. And I mean, and tight ends aren't necessarily performing at a super high level, so right. You don't really need a huge return there. I don't think Kraft's going to be dead by any sense of the imagination.
I think
it is a little weird that everyone's just automatically just shifted to how good Kraft is, and we've just erased the fact that there's another guy there that they drafted that, I don't know. It just seems weird to me that we're so quick to anoint him, where other times it takes forever.
I think as a young tight end goes, take away Brock Bowers and, you know, my Lions tight end, Laporta, you know, Kraft has been really, really good for a young. I think the reason that they've anointed him is because he's been extremely good, especially per target. They just stock up Jordan Love again because they got players everywhere. I think Kraft is awesome. Jason was just showing you his points. Like you said, there's not a lot of tight ends actually doing real work, so you could do a lot worse having to plug in Tucker Kraft. It's just that you see that 0 2 weeks ago, he was in my lineup that week, you know? So, like, there's so many options for the Packers. They don't have to throw it to him. Like, he's not one of the top guys as far as target earners every week. He's really, really good when they throw him the ball. I agree. I think Musgrave is a really good playmaker. He's not as well-rounded of a tight end as Kraft. He's not going to be in there in-line blocking on the goal line and those goal line packages and get as many touchdown opportunities. Now, is he going to score them from 30 yards out more often? Possibly. But Kraft has been really good after the catch.
Kraft's been great. I mean,
so I think right this second for the run part of it, I think Kraft is probably going to be pretty expensive because of everything you just said. I think Musgrave, it was going to be on my list of things he was going to come up in this conversation no matter what, but like, he is a huge buy because he is probably as close to free as any like tight end that we've seen make plays. We haven't seen a lot out of him, but even in preseason and before he got hurt and last year, like, he's made some big time plays. And so I think Musgrave is a huge buy because his price tag is so low. I think Kraft is a big time buy because he showed me enough. 6'5", 260, and, you know, he's not 6'3", 240, right? Like, he's 6'5", 260, and with the ball in his hands, looks really, really fluid.
No, yeah,
so
1,000%.
To me, Kraft long-term has made me feel real good. I got him in the FFPC league with a short bench, and I'm like, oh, I'm super crowded over here with some tight ends, and I'm just Kraft's on my bench. I've got so many guys on the IR, and I got people hurt everywhere, which is why he was in my lineup last week with that 2 weeks ago with that zero. But I'm so happy to have him on my bench. It clogging me up because he's just quality player.
Yeah. No, I'm not like hard sell, and I'm completely out. But I mean, if somebody wants to give me something decent for Kraft, I might get out of that. And I don't think I'm buying in for the run. Two cheap guys just to buy as rebuilders or whatever. Theo Johnson, we talked about him a couple shows ago, and JT Sanders, two of my favorites there, and then Musgrave. And then just so that we'll hit every position, Dak Prescott and Trevor Lawrence are just fading into the abyss of freeness, and I'll buy them right now as a quarterback position.
Yeah, so I'll take that. You got buttons? I thought you had something. I thought you had a coming. Dak has laid so much. I missed it. What did it say?
Bull junk.
What was that?
Dion saying bull junk.
Oh, I don't even know. There you go. I mean, Dak for me has laid it down so many times, you know, MVP caliber kind of stuff. Obviously, Trevor's looked really good in some spaces of time.
If you take away all the bad plays.
Right. If you take away all the bad games, Trevor's amazing.
It's the worst plays that he's made. Take those away.
I mean, obviously, Trevor's going to be a really good buy this offseason. His stock's going to be as low as it's ever been since he came into the league. But Dak right now, he did nothing wrong. The Cowboys fell apart. Jerry Jones stood over here. He's still rationalizing why it's okay and the right decision not to get Derrick Henry. Dak did nothing wrong.
Right.
And then he gets hurt and he's on IR.
Yeah. And he just wasn't good this season. Like, it was.
He wasn't excellent. He wasn't horrible.
He wasn't god awful, but he was. Was a little rough this season. Wasn't MVP Dak.
Give me all the Dak on the chicken. Yeah. Five, six round startup pick Dak. Come on. Auto pick.
Yeah.
Number one off-season QB by C.J. Stroud.
Well, yeah, I didn't want to pose the question of who's this year's Joe Burrow, but, you know, that was the question I had on here. We're just out of time.
Okay.
So I didn't, but I think C.J. Stroud is going to get the Burrow treatment this year, fall back to the end of the first as Superflex drafts.
Pick him up.
So, yeah.
Buy the dip.
Moves to make every position for your pleasure. We'll catch you next week. We'll do Monday reviews of the week of foosball, and we'll still talk fantasy in there for your pleasure, but going to hit that for you. Be sure to rate, review on iTunes, Spotify, all that stuff. 5 stars would be excellent. Subscribe. Come on over to the Patreon side of things. There's going to be a lot of good stuff going down over there. $5 holler and a free Discord. Make sure you check that out. Until next time, peace out.